Well, in just the past 20 years, horror films have grossed over $25 billion at the box office.
A movie is a safe way for them to confront it, is knowing they're safe in a movie seat.
Explore America's obsession with thrillers and horror stories on today's 700 Club Interactive. On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today. Well, welcome to the show. It's that time of year when horror films make it big at the box office. And with the release of Paranormal Activity 4 and Sinister, Hollywood is expecting a very profitable month.
It's strange that movies that scare people are so popular. So today, New York Times bestselling author Ted Dekker is going to join us to shed light on our fascination with fear. He's sold over 5 million thrillers, two of which have made it to the big screen. Take a look.
All of my stories are extreme in some ways. They don't fit into a particular genre. They're primarily driven by a thirst for understanding and a thirst for escape and excitement. That's why I write thrillers, for something new. Isn't that why people read books? They want to explore something that's not mundane to them. They want to escape. I have an insatiable appetite for fresh experience. Now, you can hardly blame me. I grew up in the jungle with all kinds of experience that you would see as extreme. So it's influenced me that way.
Oh, please welcome suspense writer Ted Dekker. Ted, welcome to 700 Club Interactive.
Gordon, it's so good to be with you again.
Tell me, why do we like to feel afraid? It seems like we go out of our way, whether it's on a roller coaster or sitting in a dark movie theater watching a horror film. Why do we like it so much?
Well, I don't know about you, but I don't. I don't like fear at all. In fact, writing about fear is essentially, for me, a safe way to work through fear. I think perfect love casts out fear. And actually, fear is a phantom. It's a misunderstanding of our true identity in Christ. And I don't write about horror. Now, my books are like mirrors. So depending on where you're coming from, you will feel fear if you identify with that fear. And I have certainly in the past. But you know, the one psalm, you know, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. That's a very telling psalm. I mean, it's beautiful because, first of all, in that psalm, we do walk through the valleys, but they only have shadows of death. It's not, the death has been conquered. There's good news. My books are about love and light and hope beyond this idea that death is going to destroy us. So my characters do feel fear, and my readers do, but my stories are love stories about light and redemption and beauty, because the truth is, that's who we are. We are the children of God. We do not need to fear death at all, and yet we do. You know, it's strange how that happens, yeah?
Yeah, it is strange how that happens, and it's also strange to me that some of us, and you know, maybe you and I are the exception to the rule. I really don't like going to horror films. I don't want to put myself through that experience. Yeah. I used to really like roller coasters, but I probably haven't been on one for two decades now. But there does seem to be a fascination, if you will, with, you know, even, you know, I'll take the phrase from Star Wars, with the dark side of things, that people want to investigate that. They these shows about ghost hunters that are so popular now. Why do you think that we're strangely attracted to that?
Well, again, I can only speak from my experience. I'm not strangely attracted to it. So, you know, it's difficult to say. You can talk to a psychologist about that. I write about people who are thrown into situations that might bring them great fear. Like my latest novel, The Sanctuary, is about a priest who goes to prison, and it's a very dark experience for him. But ultimately, he discovers in the darkness that if he surrenders to the love, God's love, there's nothing to fear. There is no fear in that valley. It's only a shadow of death. And I write to discover the light. So why do people feel fear? Well, I think because they buy into it. And a movie is a safe way for them to confront it. It's almost kind of has a a therapeutic value, I think, for a lot of people. They confront it knowing they're safe in a movie seat. They're not going to get hurt. You know, they get to confront that, and they come out safe on the other side. When they leave the movie theater, they're safe. So they're like, oh, it's okay. I'm okay. I look for a much greater light, a much greater hope beyond just that one experience. Because in me, I understand that I am, as God's child, I am impervious to death. There is good news, and that is the grave has been conquered. There is no need for fear at all.
You grew up a son of missionaries, and you were in the jungles of Indonesia. Is part of your, I guess, the source for some of your fiction, what you went through as a child? How did it affect your storytelling?
Yeah, my parents went to the jungle to bring light into the darkness. That is my obsession. But not so much to bring light into the darkness for the people that read my books, yes, but it's my own, it's working through my own salvation, my own understanding of who I am, my identity. Who am I? Why do I fear? My experience, you know, I grew up amongst people that were, smothered by darkness in the jungle. And, you know, in a way, I, as a missionary kid, I come to the United States and I find that I can have the same kind of fear, like no better. And even as a Christian, I can have the same kind of fear. Why? So I work through that in my stories to discover for myself. That's why they come across quite authentic, is because I'm actually writing books to take my own journey, and then I put them out. They're like my journals. And people read them and they identify with them and they go, wow, yeah. But ultimately, it's all about love. It's all about bringing light into the darkness. That's really all that matters.
What's your greatest fear?
My greatest fear, everyone's greatest fear is the same when they dig really, really deep down inside, and that is separation from God. Mm-hmm. That is, I'm not okay. I'm not good enough. I am bad. I'm not good enough to be truly loved. Because when we understand how much God loves us, we understand that we are His children, made in His image. God cannot be threatened. Can anything threaten God? Has God ever been threatened by anything? You could even ask the question, has God even struggled ever? God is too big to struggle with something called evil. He's far too big, and yet we struggle. But we are His children. We're His heirs. And so we also have that assurance that nothing can ever hurt us. That's a journey to get to that point of discovery.
It is a journey. I went through it on the mission field myself, going into some fairly dark places where they were given over to idol worship and a lot of witchcraft. And it was amazing that how much fear gripped the Christians I was with, and they would want to engage in all this spiritual warfare and binding things. And just the thought came to me, what can darkness do to light?
Oh, that's such a beautiful thought.
And when I got that one, it was like, boy, talk about light going on. What can darkness do to light? And all we have to do is go in there and shine the light. And there's nothing darkness can do but flee. It's got to run away in the presence of the light. That was a real turning point for me and got me through a whole bunch.
That's beautiful, Gordon. I mean, really just... it's not so much what should we do. The question is what should we be? How are we being right now? Well, we are light. Just, you don't have to teach a light how to shine in the darkness. It just needs to turn on.
Right.
Just turn on. Just be connected. Be one with God, you know? And that alone, that single thing you just spoke, that is actually at the very core of everything. We have all these methods in which we do and be light unto the world. But you can't be light unless you're turned on.
Right. And that's the original Greek behind manifest, that is like, you know, the light turning on. It's a light image using. Anyway, Ted, thanks for being with us.
It is very good news.
Yeah, it's very good news. And all we have to do is shine. His latest book, The Sanctuary, it's available wherever books are sold. And Ted, thanks again for being with us. God bless you.
Great cover.
You're welcome.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, it's a great looking book. Good job, Ted. Well, still ahead, you're never too young to experience the power of prayer. We want you to watch what happens when a little boy prays for his best friend to be healed. And that's next.
The game show of biblical proportions is back with more action, more fun, more stars, Kirk Franklin, Mary Mary, and more nuns.
The nuns just whooped you, man.
The American Bible Challenge, Season 2, premieres Thursday, March 21st at 9, 8 Central, only on GSN. Visit GSNTV.com to find GSN in your area.
I started feeling pain between my spine and my shoulder blade. All I had was pain and no relief. There was a sizable mass consistent with a malignant cancer in upper right lung. And that's complex, that's tough stuff. I was walking, talking, but I didn't know how sick I was.
I remembered seeing the ad for Cancer Treatment Centers of America, and I thought, this is the place he needs to be.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
The game plan was chemotherapy and radiation throughout the whole period. It was an aggressive plan of attack, and I liked that.
We gave him chemotherapy and radiation. He was an amazing patient. He tolerated treatment exceptionally well.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is different. You feel it the moment you call or walk into one of our hospitals. It's state-of-the-art medicine, unique treatment options, and a level of compassion that cannot be copied. Why? Our people. People who give you not only their expertise, but their humanity, and the most thoughtful, well-organized, patient-centered care you'll find anywhere.
My strength came back. I began to become myself again.
George does have his life back now. He has a life that I never thought he was gonna have.
With the teamwork, the treatment plans, the facilities, the combination of all the aspects of the treatment, I'm so happy that I went to CTCA.
Every minute counts when you're fighting complex or advanced stage cancer, so please call or visit cancercenter.com today. Appointments are available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
When a little boy in Nigeria got sick, it wasn't a doctor who helped him get well. It was his best friend from school who used something he saw on CBN's animated program, Superbook.
Like most boys his age, Adams likes to play ball, watch television, and read comics with his best friend, Winner. They attend the same school and sit right next to each other in class. But one day, Winner didn't come to school.
So someone now told us that he was ill.
Adams missed his friend and hoped he'd get better soon. Then he remembered an episode of Superbook he saw at Vacation Bible School. The lesson was all about prayer and healing. So he got on his knees and prayed for Winner. The next morning, his entire class prayed. And the day after that, Winner was back in school.
How I felt about Winner was that I was so surprised. I was happy that Winner came to school. So I said that if God can answer this Winner's prayer, then he can also answer everything.
It made me feel that I know that God has not forgotten me.
Adams has been encouraged ever since. He says he's closer to God and wants to tell others about Jesus.
Thank you, CBN, for the materials you've sent. They've helped me become a better boy.
He is too much. I just think he's awesome. And you know, I love the fact that he's learned this spiritual truth from materials that you've made possible. If you're a 700 Club member, we just want to say thank you. Superbook, as you've heard us talking about, has been totally revised. We're doing a current updated version of it. It's top-notch quality. And we want to teach the children of the world Bible stories. We want them to hear it from the Word of God, so it's done using the Word of God. I want you to know that our latest sequel is to Superbook is this Ten Commandments. It's the story of Moses and the Ten Commandments. And We want you to help us with this because we're going through the whole Bible, and it's going to touch the lives of children like Winner and Adams all around the world. And you can help us do that with your gift of $25. We'll send you this latest one for that gift. You'll get it in DVD form. You'll enjoy this. And also, if you'd like to be a part of our Superbook Club, that means for $25 a month, every 4 to 6 weeks when a new one of these DVDs comes out, you'll automatically get it. And you're going to be helping us translate these into different languages, send them to the children of the world. What a wonderful opportunity to teach them God's Word in a very visual, easy-to-remember way. If you'd like to be a part of that, all you have to do right now is call the number that you see on your screen. It's toll-free. It's 1-888-777-1999. Or you can log on to cbn.com and join us in this project that way. So, one-time gift of $25 will get you the latest release. $25 a month by joining the Super Club program will mean that you'll get every one of these as they come out, and they are awesome. Your kids will love them. Well, up next, a fantasy artist faces the reality of what she's created.
All these dark images, I'm watching them come out of the printer. They had power and secret knowledge that all is wrapped up with the occult. There was some kind of demonic possession going on here.
See how these dark images haunted her own daughter after this.
When staying together seems unmanageable.
I would say without exaggerating that we fought every day.
When forgiveness seems impossible.
I didn't care if I lived or died. I didn't care what happened anymore.
There is a way through.
It is a divine intervention into two people's lives.
I'll just never forget having this renewed sense of, I think we can do this.
Secrets to a Successful Marriage Revealed on the 700 Club, starting Monday.
Lighting is my specialty. Have you ever heard of a Leco? How about a Fresnel? These are just a couple of the lights that we use. We could change an entire scene by just pushing a button. I'll light up your light. We have hundreds of gels to choose from. We can add warmth and texture to the image. I love making people look good inside or out. We bounce light, we feel light, and sometimes we even silhouette. My name is Randy Reed, and I'm a lighting director, and I work at CBN.
CBN TV on CBN.com. All the video you love in one easy-to-use location.
The game show of biblical proportions is back with more action, more fun, more stars, Kirk Franklin, Mary Mary, and more nuns.
The nuns just whooped you, man.
The American Bible Challenge, Season 2, premieres Thursday, March 21st at 9, 8 Central, only on GSN. Visit GSNTV.com to find GSN in your area.
Jessica Galbraith achieved international fame in the world of fantasy art. Her dark creations attracted a cult following, and many of her fans thought she was a witch. Jessica reveled in her reputation until that art began to take on a life of its own.
I think it's very, very likely that there was some kind of demonic possession going on here. I almost felt like there was a cloud of darkness around me.
For years, Jessica Galbraith was known worldwide as a fantasy artist. Her specialties were vampires, winged fairies, and haunting gothic goddesses.
I would try to give them a look like, you know, they were gazing at you with bad intent. They had power and secret knowledge that all is wrapped up with the occult.
It was a power that Jessica discovered when she was a child.
I think I always had a strong sense that there was a supernatural world. So it kind of progressed from liking the pretty unicorns to buying a tarot deck and bringing it home and doing readings for my friends and getting a Ouija board. And we would ask for someone to come talk to us, inviting anyone, whoever's out there, come talk to us. Things would happen all the time. Unexplainable things, terrifying things.
She saw radios scream on out of nowhere, as well as flying picture frames, broken glass, and complete power outages.
the spirits that you think might be ghosts. They're not, they're demons. We were inviting them in, so they thought, let's mess with these girls, you know, let's terrify them.
Jessica stopped using Ouija boards in high school, but kept seeking the supernatural.
I was looking for knowledge and power and secrets that I thought maybe other people didn't know. I would say that people thought I was a witch.
More than anything, Jessica was curious about death.
I would read any kind of book I could get my hands on in the New Age about near-death experience or the paranormal. My greatest fear was that there was either nothing after death and you're just, you know, annihilated, or worse, that there was a hell and that I was going there.
Jessica majored in art in college and began creating images that reflected her obsession with death. She married Josh and they had two kids.
I was very empty inside. Josh and I both were really financially driven, and we would set these goals for ourselves, and once we would reach them, we would be dissatisfied again.
As her artwork got darker, she began noticing that her daughter Julia was having abnormal fears. The images from Jessica's paintings were becoming real to Julia.
I was afraid of my parents or I dying. I used to have nightmares about this troll guy giving me poison and then driving me away in this brown Jeep.
Jessica and Josh took Julia to a therapist, but the fear and the nightmares continued. Not long after this, the couple sent their son Joe to a preschool that happened to be Christian. The father of one of Joe's classmates befriended Josh and began questioning the couple about their beliefs. Jessica's mother and stepfather were Christians, and Jessica had already decided that she didn't want anything to do with Jesus.
I felt that perhaps God was just a set of rules, a judgmental, scary, authoritarian figure. But I felt like he was removed, and we were just kind of off on our own here, and there was no Satan. There was no, you know, it was just all our imagination. I was very prideful at this point, and I didn't need to be saved from anything. I had fallen for that deception that it was trying to hold women down. It was a male-dominated religion. And he was able to show me in the Bible how that's not the case at all.
As Jessica and Josh read the Bible, everything they had believed and not believed changed.
I read the Gospel of John first, and I remember looking at Josh saying, wow, I think this is it. This is the truth. And my heart softened, and I believed that Jesus was who he said he was. He was God, and the Bible is the word of God. And I just remember him, Dan, looking at us and say, he just said point blank, well, have you guys accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? And we both blurted out, yes, and we meant it. I remember Dan saying, well, then your eternity is settled. Isn't that something?
When Jessica got home, she had to face the reality of the evil characters she'd created and introduced to others.
All these dark images, I'm watching them come out of the printer. And I'm thinking about everything, and I just felt utter despair.
Jessica called her mom.
And I just said, Mom, I just accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I said, but I don't know what to do. I don't feel like he can forgive me. And she said, for your art? I said, yeah. And she said, because it's kind of satanic. And it just really hit me, like, yes, it's the truth. And just something told me, go open the shade. It wasn't a voice that I heard, it was just in my heart. And I crawled over, tears coming down, and I lifted the shade, and there was a huge rainbow just straight up over the field. And I just felt like God walked right in that room with me and said, I forgive you, it's okay. I haven't looked back since.
Jessica and Josh literally dumped all of the dark artwork they had in their house. Jessica removed herself from everything to do with the occult. The couple started going to church and studying the Bible.
If you come to him, he will give you rest, and that's what I've experienced. So I just feel like a big weight was lifted off of our lives.
Jessica is no longer afraid of death, and neither is Julia.
I'm not afraid because Jesus is with me and he protects me.
Today, the message in Jessica Galbraith's artwork is hope and life. It has nothing to do with death and darkness, and everything to do with the light of Christ.
All of it to me is a miracle that someone like me could find their faith, find him. It's like a veil lifts when you see it. and all the power or, you know, intrigue that you thought was with the occult is nothing compared to the light of God and His supernatural power. And I want everyone to know that God forgives anything, and His grace is big enough for all of us, and all you have to do is ask.
God does forgive anything, and He loves you more than you could hope for or imagine. You know, earlier we heard Ted Dekker talk about the fact that he writes about light. He writes about the kind of things that Jessica paints about right now. And Gordon talked about that the darkness can't quench the light. But lots of times the quenching, the sort of shade that comes over our eyes so that we can't see that she's talking about, the thing that blocks us from God, is our own unwillingness to surrender ourselves. And why do we do that? Why do we make it so difficult? I think it's because we don't know His love, so how can we trust Him? But God wants to know you. He wants to show you who He is. He wants to love you with the kind of love that is life-changing. You can see it in this little family story, can't you? You can see it in their children. God wants to do that for you. If there's a darkness in your life, if you feel like you have blinders on to truth, if you are burdened and heavy laden, Jesus says, come to me. Come to me. I want to give you rest. I want you to know who I am. He's not a God who hides from us or makes it difficult for us to know Him. He's there. He's available, but we have to choose to come. We have to say something as simple as, God, show me who you are. I want to know you. I want to know you. Jessica talked about being too prideful to do that. I think a lot of us go through a time like that in our lives where we think we've got a better answer, a better way. Sometimes it's not until something brings us to the end of ourselves that we say, God, God, show me who you are. You can have all of me. And then once we experience Him, we ask ourselves, why did we wait so long when all of this was available? You see, the Bible says that God does not wish that anyone would perish, that anyone would live with fear in their hearts or a lack of understanding about who He is. He wants all of us to be with Him. We were created to that end. But we have a choice. We're not automatons. We have a choice. God wants to love us, and He wants us to be able to love Him in return. If you haven't experienced the amazing love of God, if it hasn't just rocked your world and turned your life around, today's the day to start that. You just ask Him. You just ask Him. Just pray right now. Stop what you're doing and say, God, I want to know what Jessica knows. I want to know you in every aspect of my life. I want to understand how much you love me, and I want to give you my heart. I want to give you my life. I want to give you my future. I want to know why you created me. All those questions are answered in a relationship with Jesus Christ. And it's the most exciting day-to-day adventure you'll ever embark on. If you'd like to pray with someone about a need in your life, you can call that number that's on your screen, 1-888-777-1999. We want you to know about the Lord. And if you'd like to receive this, maybe you've prayed that prayer. Maybe that's your heart desire right now, and you just want to have a quiet conversation with the Lord. Do that, and then call and ask us for this. It's a packet that has been put together with you in mind. It's called A New Day. It's filled with information on what do you do after you pray the prayer? How do you grow in your relationship with the Lord? We've got it all here. It's free, and it's for you. 1-888-777-1999. Gordon?
Well, we've got some inbox questions on today's topic. Patrick writes in, I believe in spirits like demons and angels, but I hear people say things like human spirits in reference to ghosts. When we die, aren't our only options heaven and hell? We don't become ghosts, do we? Well, in the New Testament, Paul writes that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And so let that be the hope of all Christians everywhere, that to be absent from the body means that you're translated into his presence. There is one instance where the witch of Endor is consulted by Saul, and to her surprise, she's startled by the spirit of Samuel coming and being with them in the room, that literally he was called back from the dead, and Samuel's kind of mad about it, that Why did you wake me up? If God won't answer your prayer, why do you think I will? And so that's the one instance. But in New Testament times, and this is after the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, it appears to have changed things. So be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And so there aren't a bunch of human ghosts running around. So all the time we have, we leave with this word from Psalm 56. But when I am afraid, I put my trust in you. For Terry, for me, for all of us here, God bless you. We'll see you again.